A very good afternoon. I hope my voice, audio and video is fine. So today is the second session where I'll be discussing the image-based questions. So let's start with the image-based questions now. So before I start with the session, I am Dr. Ramya Sri. I teach obstetrics and gynecology. And so I've been doing the series, and yesterday also I've done a series where I discussed some of the images with the clinical-based questions. So today also we are going to continue the same, that is we'll discuss some MCQs along with the clinical based questions, right? Okay, I know it looks little scary seeing a such big question, but yes, believe me, it's a very simple question. Okay, so I just want to remove that fear of big questions or image from you, because all those are conceptual and we don't go wrong in conceptual if our concepts are strong enough. And usually in obstetrics and gynecology, the concepts are easy to understand and they will be strong enough for you to answer more and more. Very good morning, Krishnan. Yes, Sridhant, I agree with you. It's too long, but let us read. It will become very simple for us. So a 45-year-old lady comes with heavy and painful menstruation. So she has two problems here. That is, she has heavy as well as painful menstruation. Which since last 2 to 3 years, they have become almost unbearable. She bleeds every 24 days and the periods last for 8 to 9 days. So whenever they have a bleeding of more than 80 ml or bleeding for more than 8 days, we call it as heavy menstrual bleeding with very heavy flow from day 2 to day 6. The pain starts approximately 36 hours before the onset of bleeding and lasts until about 5 days. Now, can you tell me what type of dysmenorrhea is this? Is it primary dysmenorrhea or a secondary dysmenorrhea? Primary dysmenorrhea is also called as spasmodic and secondary is also called as congestive. So can I know what type of dysmenorrhea are we dealing with? So you can write in the comment box. Till then I'll be reading and then I'll come back to the same question. The pain is constant, dull and severe, such that she cannot do any household work or any social activities during this time. Her general practitioner has prescribed paracetamol and mefenamic acid in combination, which she says takes the edge off but does not fully relieve the symptoms. She is Para-5 living 5, tubectomized. There is no history of intermenstrual or postcoital discharge, or she has no abnormal discharge. Now, by the entire history, what are the key points which you have learnt? So I'll speak about that. So she is 45 years, point number one. Any question of obstetrics and gynecology, please observe the age and parity. Para-5, living 5. Family is completed. Tubectomized means family completed. So a 45-year-old whose family is completed, so I have to think in terms where family is completed, her management, right? Okay. Next, what are the problems she's having? She is having heavy menstrual bleeding plus dysmenorrhea. Primary dysmenorrhea usually starts with the menstruation and usually will be present only for the first 1 day, preferably in the first 6 to 12 hours. But here it started prior, 36 hours prior, and it continued throughout the cycle. So it is a type of secondary congestive dysmenorrhea. So there might be a underlying disease which is causing this secondary congestive dysmenorrhea. Now guys, can you tell me any differential diagnosis where a patient can have heavy menstrual bleeding and secondary congestive dysmenorrhea? Excellent, Niharika and Siddhant, very good. Can you suggest me any differential diagnosis based on the history? Now, if you are a final year student, this is how the questions they can ask you in the practicals also. Based on your history, they'll always ask you what are the DDs you have in your, because they're more impressed the more DDs you answer. So what might cause heavy menstrual bleeding and secondary congestive dysmenorrhea? So yes, the first thing which I can think of is a favorite for all the students, that is fibroid. Now a fibroid can have both congestive dysmenorrhea as well as it can also have heavy menstrual bleeding. So I will think in terms of fibroid here one. Excellent, Kritika. So you can think in terms of fibroid and adenomyosis. Adenomyosis is also one thing where there can be presence of heavy menstrual bleeding plus dysmenorrhea, right? So let's read the perabdomen findings now. The abdomen is soft and there is vague tenderness in the suprapubic area. The cervix is normal. On bimanual palpation, the uterus is approximately 10 weeks size, soft and bulky. She is tender on palpation. Uterus is tender on palpation, but there is no cervical excitation, adnexal tenderness or adnexal masses. Now you answer. So we had two differential diagnoses in our brain. That is, one is adenomyosis and one was fibroid. Based on the perabdomen findings, where is it going? Which has a tender uterus? Does the fibroid has a tender uterus or adenomyosis has a tender uterus? So usually the adenomyosis has the tender uterus. And tender uterus in adenomyosis is called as Halbenstein. Tender uterus in adenomyosis is called as Halbenstein. So Halbenstein is positive here, right? So according to the history and examination, this looks like a adenomyosis for all of us. So what is the diagnosis? This is a USG picture. Based on the USG picture, what do you see? You see a poorly circumscribed hyperechoic heterogeneous mass. Right? Now what will present to you with this finding? So usually fibroid will be homogeneous, circumscribed and hypoechoic mass, right? So this confirms the diagnosis of adenomyosis. In adenomyosis, the first investigation is USG or the TVS, whereas the gold investigation of choice is MRI. Gold standard is laparoscopy. So the first investigation is USG, investigation of choice is MRI, whereas the gold standard is laparoscopy, right? So that is, what is the diagnosis here is the adenomyosis. And do you know the findings of adenomyosis on USG called as? So the findings on findings of USG in adenomyosis is called as salt and pepper appearance and Venetian blind appearance. Right? So that is one name. And on MRI, you will have the junctional zone thickness. Junctional zone thickness will be more than 12 mm to call it as adenomyosis. What is the management? Try to choose the option, best option suitable for her. Okay? Just give me a minute. I'll be back. You think of management, I'll come back.
ಅಂತ ಕಷ್ಟಪಟ್ಟು ಅಂತ ಕಷ್ಟ ಅಂತ ಕಷ್ಟ
Right, so what should be the management? Yes, diagnosis of adenomyosis, you all wrote correct. Now, actually, the question should have been more precise by asking, you know, I'll ask you 2 points here. What should be the first line management and what should be the best management for her? So she is 45 years old. I think first we can manage her. We don't require to knock out the uterus immediately. I agree to you that she is para 5, living 5, family completed. So you might ask me, why can't we knock out the uterus and go for hysterectomy? You don't require to knock out the uterus and go for hysterectomy here because point number one, no, don't go for hysterectomy is what I'm trying to teach you here. Because she's anyway perimenopausal woman. So she might approach menopause in another 1 or 2 years. So why can't you try with something which can stop her symptoms and pull her to menopause? And what will happen to all these symptoms in menopause? Menopause, automatically all these symptoms will subside. Because adenomyosis, the main thing is endometrium going into the myometrium. And endometrium going into the myometrium is and that endometrium grows because of the estrogen and estrogen. So when she goes into menopause, she has natural amenorrhea and all these tissues will regress back. Right? So her symptoms will be cured naturally. So as she is approaching menopause, why can't we first try with medication? That is hormonal medication. So which hormonal medication acts as a first line and which hormonal medication acts as a drug of choice? So the first line for the endometriosis is progesterone or adenomyosis is progesterone. So the option I have here, which is a progesterone, is injection DMPA. So that is why the most appropriate answer would be here, injection DMPA, right? So yes, excellent Siddhant, you can answer it as Mirina. So I am teaching image based questions for obstetrics and gynecology for NEET PG category. Now, so I just wanted you to show the images of, you know, the differential diagnosis also. You know, I have a beautiful pictures. Can you tell me what is this first picture telling us about? What is this first picture? So this is the uterus, this is the myometrium, this is the endometrium. So what are you seeing here? Circumscribed, homogeneous, hypoechoic mass. Right, so this is a fibroid. This is a fibroid, right? Excellent. So it's a posterior wall fibroid. So can you see the difference? How does a fibroid look and how does adenomyosis look? And are you confident enough that next time if you get an image of adenomyosis as well as a fibroid, you will be in a position to differentiate? So I'll just erase it again. So this is how the adenomyosis looks like. So adenomyosis is heterogeneous. Heterogeneous, not circumscribed, okay? Salt and pepper appearance it's looking like, right? Let's see this. It is homogeneous, well circumscribed, hypoechoic. Now, I think Frost, this class is too far from the 12th class, 12th. So you can wait for some more years and once you enter the postgrad MBBS, then you can start seeing this. Okay, so don't overload your brain with obstetrics and gynecology from now itself. Right. So that I was telling about a comment to the live chat box. Right. So now next is we have the endometrium. This is the endometrium. And you see the endometrium is showing some triple line. So this is a thickened endometrium. This is a thickened endometrium, right? So this is also one image which I just kept to show you. This is a thickened endometrium. So I'm just trying to tell you all the points here on the TVS for our adenomyosis. So usually there will be posterior wall bulkiness. Myometrium is heterogeneous with hyperechoic areas, which is called as salt and pepper appearance. There will be myometrial cysts, and myometrial cysts is one of the very diagnostic feature for diagnosing the adenomyosis. thickening of transition zone more than 12 mm. Subendometrial striations. Can you see how this picture actually had very good striations? See nicely they have. 1, 2, 3. Beautiful actually. So subendometrial striation called as Venetian blind appearance. Okay. So that is about the adenomyosis. And adenomyosis is usually seen in multigravida patients. And the symptoms with which they present to you mainly is dysmenorrhea and dyspareunia. And heavy menstrual bleeding. This is the specimen of the adenomyosis. You know, sometimes they can also give you a specimen of the adenomyosis also. Actually, NEET 2019, there was a question on specimen of adenomyosis, right? So this is a specimen of adenomyosis. How are you going to answer that this is adenomyosis? Is again, if you observe, posterior wall has become too bulky. So posterior wall myohyperplasia, and you have subendometrial myometrial cysts. Can you see the myometrial cysts? So we have the subendometrial myometrial cysts. Okay. So was it an easy question or not? Although the question looked big, you know, the answer was so evident from the big questions. So whenever you get a big question, you should be happy because, you know, the answer is so much evident. You know, as the question becomes big, they will be like, you know, this is the answer. This is the answer it is showing, right? Let's go to the next question now. A 39-year-old woman presents with lower abdominal pain for 4 years. Occurring with her periods, again a type of dysmenorrhea. She takes paracetamol and ibuprofen and goes to the bed with a hot water bottle for up to 2 days every month. For last 18 months, pain has occurred in between periods also. So she's getting pain during her menstrual cycles, and she's also getting her pain even in between the cycles also. The pain is dull, constant, across the lower abdominal pain, lower abdomen. Her periods are regular, there is no menorrhagia, intermenstrual or postcoital bleeding. There is no other significant history. She has been married 12 years, para 2 living 2, family completed, and she has deep dysmenorrhea, which makes her interrupt the intercourse. Now, based on this history, I want you to answer what is your diagnosis. Very good afternoon, Achan Khan. So what is the diagnosis for this? So she has dysmenorrhea and dyspareunia. What has the triad of dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia and infertility? Actually infertility, but she is not infertile. So probably she developed later. Excellent, Siddharth and Niharika. So this looks like an endometriosis. And what is the most consistent symptom of endometriosis? What is the most consistent symptom of endometriosis? It is the pain. Painful menstruation, right? Very good, great Nepal dreamer. Correct, this is an endometriosis. Now, do you know endometriosis? What is the dysmenorrhea of the endometriosis called as? The dysmenorrhea caused by endometriosis is called as triple dysmenorrhea or progressive dysmenorrhea. Why? It's called triple dysmenorrhea because she has pain before menstrual cycle, she has pain during menses, and she has pain even after menstrual cycle. So she has pain throughout because of the adhesions which she has developed. So because of that adhesions, when she has pain throughout, we call it as triple dysmenorrhea. And the pain increases gradually, so we also call it as progressive dysmenorrhea. Like she had, this patient had only first during the menstruation. Later she developed even after the menstruation, even in between menstruation. So that's why we call it as progressive dysmenorrhea. Excellent, Raksha. Very good. So on examination, there is generalized lower abdominal tenderness. So that is confirming our diagnosis. Particularly in the suprapubic area, but no masses palpable. Speculum examination is unremarkable. On bimanual examination, uterus is axial fixed with cervical excitation. The pouch of Douglas is very tender and contains a mass. The adnexa are both tender, but no adnexal masses are palpable. What is the first line management for this? So what is the first line management for this? So this is the adnexa which they have shown. So it looks like a cyst. Do you know what is this appearance of the cyst called as, and what are these cysts? Who can answer me that? So this is called as ground glass appearance of the endometriotic cyst. This is called ground glass appearance of the endometriotic cyst. So these are nothing but the endometriotic cyst or the chocolate cyst. What is the first line management for her? Now you know what? We understood what was they speaking for so long. I think by history itself, I was pretty sure that this is an endometriotic cyst. But in spite of that, we are going wrong in the management. Why? They are chocolate cysts. I agree with all of you, they are chocolate cysts. But the management is not lap cystectomy. Why? Because she's 39 years old and her family is completed. The first line, I can give her progesterone for the regression of those cysts. Again, if I create an amenorrheic state, automatically there won't be further bleeding in the ovary and there will be fibrosis and the cyst will regress to normal size. So you have to go for urgent cystectomy when she wants to conceive. But when they don't want to conceive, there is no harm. You can just wait. You can try with the medical managements. So you can give LNG IUCD, or you can give injection DMP, or you can give dihydrogestrone. So as I have the option of DMPA, I'll go with injection DMPA. And you can also go with JNRH analog, but they have asked what is the first line. So that is why the answer here will be A, injection DMPA. Is it clear, guys? Okay. If they would have asked what is the drug of choice, 100% my answer would have gone with GnRH analogs. So that was the second one more beautiful question. Now let's see the third beautiful question. A 48-year-old woman presents with intermenstrual bleeding for 2 months. Episodes of bleeding occur any time in the cycle. This is usually fresh red blood and much lighter than a period. It can last for 1 to 6 days. There is no associated pain. She has no hot flushes or night sweats. She is sexually active and has not noticed any vaginal dryness. She has 3 children and has used the progesterone only pill for contraception for 5 years. Her last smear was 2 years ago and all smears are normal. So just to tell us that this intermenstrual bleed is not related to cervical cancer. She takes no medication and has no other relevant medical history. So only positive history from this question is what? Very good. The positive history from this question is intermenstrual bleeding, which is fresh red blood. Right. Do you know what are the differential diagnoses which you have for the intermenstrual bleeds? And that's the USG picture. So now who can speak about this USG picture and answer what is the appropriate answer for this? Excellent, Siddharth Satpathy. So this is a polyp. What polyp? Is it endometrial or endocervical polyp? Because I have 2 options. So this is the uterus. And this is the cervix, right? So this is the cervix and this is the uterus. Very good morning, Rahul. So you have the polyp arising from the endometrium. Excellent. So this is an endometrial polyp. This is an endometrial polyp. And you actually have on Doppler a small vessel entering into this endometrium, which is called as feeding sign. Which is called as feeding vessel sign. So this is the endometrial polyp. This is the endometrial polyp, right? So that was about one more question. Now you know what are the points which were telling that this is an endometrial polyp? Do you know what are the points which were telling us that this is an endometrial polyp? Who can tell me all the positive points which have supported our diagnosis of endometrial polyp? So point number one. Fresh red bleed, intermenstrual. So whenever there is intermenstrual bleeding, there are many differential diagnoses which can lead to intermenstrual bleeding, like a fibroid polyp or ectropion, right? But the point what here has helped me is fresh red blood is mainly seen with the endometrial polyp because it has one blood vessel which would have been bleeding. And actually one more differential diagnosis for me was, before I see the image, she was on progesterone only pills. Usually progesterone only pills in the first 6 months, they cause this irregular bleeding. That, so they can also present with intermenstrual bleeding, right? Any progesterones initially can lead to intermenstrual bleeding. So that might also be one cause, was something which was striking my brain, right? So these were the two things which actually are the differential diagnosis. But once I saw the image, it's very clear of that. Then do you know actually this saline infusion sonography is best for delineating endometrial polyp. So that is how the uterus looks distended, and that can beautifully delineate. Now how do you differentiate this from the this from fibroid polyp? So how do we differentiate between this and fibroid polyp is, endometrial polyp is, endometrial polyp and fibroid polyp. Excellent PS. So this has a narrow base. Sorry, fibroid polyp has a stalk, okay, and this fibroid polyp usually distends the uterus. Fibroid polyp is homogeneous and hyperechoic. Hypoechoic. Hypoechoic means everything becoming black. Whereas endometrial polyp is hyperechoic, white. So in simple words, white. And endometrial polyp has feeding vessel sign positive. So when you do Doppler, you will see only one vessel entering into the polyp. Whereas fibroid polyp will have scattered vascularity, usually in the periphery. Vascularity will be more in the periphery. Okay. Yes, fibroid polyp will be hypoechoic. Endometrial polyp will be hyperechoic. That means fibroid polyp will be black, whereas endometrial polyp will be white. Okay, so those are some of the findings which differentiate between the endometrial polyp and fibroid polyp. Identify the image. Do you know what is this image? Endometrial papillae, Karman's cannula. Yes, definitely Doppler helps to see the vascularity. Doppler definitely helps, Kaustu. Excellent, Siddharth. So this is a endometrial papillae biopsy. This is a endometrial papillae biopsy, right? So this has a small opening. This is a metal curette, endometrial papillae biopsy with a metal curette, right? So this requires no dilatation and it's an OPD procedure. So you can wonderfully use this in the OPD and without any circle. So you attach a syringe to it and then you do to and fro motion. With negative pressure, it sucks out the endometrial content. So it's used for biopsy, endometrial biopsy. And this is the investigation of choice. In many of the cases of endometrial, to whenever we want an endometrial biopsy, except when there is a focal mass where I have to see and take a biopsy, there or gold standard or diagnostic will be hysteroscopic DNC. But the investigation of choice for endometrial biopsy is this, because it's an OPD procedure, it requires no anesthesia and it requires no dilatation, so it is less traumatic to the cervix. That's the beauty of this. And the best thing about this is the sensitivity is 92 to 98%. Now what more do I require, right? So this is a very, very good instrument. So I think the FMG exam students have gone for the exam, right? This was in general, you know, all questions which I discuss can be beneficial for both. So that was today's session where we discussed some questions which were clinically based and which were long, but we understood the approach, how we have to do for the questions, and we saw some beautiful USG images. And yes, I'll be coming with more and more sessions like that. And next month, so that ends this month for us. Oh, how was the exam, monster? How was the exam? I'm happy, yeah, you were watching my class even from the break also. So how was the exam? How was the first part? So take a proper break, relax yourself, you know, do some thinking, nothing, just sit for idle for 5 minutes so that you get more energy for your next session starts. Please eat something. Please eat something light before you go for the next exam so that you keep that energy levels high. All the best, Monster Ellen, and I pray for you that you should get 100% above 180. I kept it moderate, you know. You previous USG images, okay. This one? So I'll just show all the images which I showed today. The first one was and please drink a lot of water also. Keep yourself hydrated. So this first image was adenomyosis. This second image was fibroid. This is thickened endometrium. This was a specimen of adenomyosis. This was ground glass appearance of chocolate cyst. And this was endometrial polyp. So I think gynec will be in the second half, no? Monster Ellen, just see some points about the episiotomy. See some points about the episiotomy. And let me think what might come, other things. So thank you guys. Today was this short session. And yes, before I end, I would like to tell you one more thing, you know. That is, next month, this is the plan for the next month, which I already thought of. And I'm thinking of starting it from, you know, 2nd September or, you know, 1st September itself. So next, actually this month, I have done all classes pertaining to ops. I've done all classes pertaining to ops. Next month, it will be mission gynecology. So I'll be concentrating first few days only on more on gynecology. So what I'm planning is we will do daily MCQ series. And in the daily MCQ series, every day I'll discuss two topics MCQs. So actually what my students have suggested me, this will all happen on the Unacademy Learning app. And yes, all these will be the free classes. So these will be the free classes. So what we will do is, one day we'll have topic-wise MCQs, one day we'll have mixed bag. You know, that way you'll be like more perfect. So last month we did obstetrics. Yes, on the Unacademy Learning app, you have to follow me. My name is Bezugam Ramyasri. You have to follow me so that you'll get update of my classes again and again, right? So one day we will have the, and you can also join the Unacademy Telegram group where we are all discuss, where we are very active and we can give you all the advices and all these also we can post it there. So one day will be topic-wise MCQ, one day will be mixed bag. So daily there'll be 1 hour free sessions. Where I'll try to finish the gynecology in that manner. That is my next month's theme or whatever I've thought of. Okay. So thank you guys. All the best and all the best to all those students who are giving exam for the FMG. All my prayers with you all. You are gonna rock it. I'm 100% sure. So the second half is the gynec. I know you'll all. There will be pretty easy questions, which everything you know. Just calm yourself, be cool. I've been telling that multiple times, but I'm telling again because being cool is the main priority. Everything you'll remember in your exam. And thank you. All the best. So timings, Alpana, I'll be posting it because this is my plan. I have to plan it and plot it and, you know, I have to write the everything what all each day and then I'll post a poster for all of you where we can follow it. And I have to look which slot is free for me to take a class. Previously, all my classes were used to be at 7 p.m. Last month, all classes I took at 7 p.m. So similarly, if I get a slot of 7 p.m. this month also, I will continue with the 7 p.m. slot. Thank you, PMDC. Thanks a lot. 100% I'll try to incorporate it, integrated and next level questions also. Thank you, guys.